I give me one minute. I can just arrange the content. Good evening. Okay, I will start the class now. So recording is on. Alright, so in this scheme, the TA ship scheme, we were given some assignments and we have to do them weekly, and we are up to week 7. So week 7 assignments are out and still 4 weeks including this week lectures have to be taken. So as done in the previous part, so these are the topics and this is how I have taken the course, the examples. So these lectures are only for practicing some numericals, some practice problems, so that student have less problem in solving the main quiz questions. So it is additional part of practicing. So as coming to practice session 8, we were to the point where we completed system with mass flow, and then so we had done till this, and then we saw the next part of the course, which was we have already done in some sort. Instead of single particle, now we have a system of particles. And so apart from the extension of the rigid bodies, we have covered the entire course. Now the major part of the course is in the analytical dynamics, and let me explain the analytical dynamics. It actually encompasses a lot of things, and so we will take 3 lectures to cover all the examples related to that. Okay, so we have this how the flow will be in practice session 9, 10 and 11 will be such that there will be general framework of the course. First of all, like I will try to connect it with other courses, then there will be lot of problem of abstraction, because that is the major part where all the value is, because how to make a model of a real system. Then there will be some information about degree of freedom and generalized coordinates. Then we will come to our major topic, which is constraint, and then we will delve into the mathematical side of usage of delta operator. Then we will look at the postulates, and then we look into the Hamilton's law of varying action, which gives us the Euler equation, Euler language equations. And we will look at something called language multiplier and how its relationship is with constraints. So let's go with general structure of this course. So let's say we have some mechanical system. Okay. So this first classification is made via linear and non-linear. Linear systems are easy to analyze, and because everything comes into form of matrices because of the superposition principle. And non-linear are not that great to solve because we don't have enough tools to get to the exact solution. Hence we compromise with the numerical solutions or the approximate solutions. In some cases it is good, but in some cases it is way different from the actual solution. So our course here is all about formulation. So before that, one more thing. The first steps come out to be abstraction. Where any physical scenario or a real world scenario can be put as a model, a mathematical model with a lot of caveats, and because we have to approximate things, and because in real world scenario everything is non-linear, everything is very complex, but we have to keep that into an engineering sense, and we have to approximate things, and we have to then come to formulation of equation of motion. Then we come to the solving of those equation of motion. So abstraction is where a real world problem or physics, it is abstracted and put in the form of mechanical system. Now that can be linear, non-linear, depending on the formulation of equation of motion, that is second step, and then is the solution of this equation of motion. Along with this equation of motion, we have forces, force analysis, that can be disturbing force. So some forces which are disturbing the mechanical system. It can be restoring force, like once it is disturbed, then it is restoring. Then inertia forces, and last damping forces. Philosophically speaking, if we consider one's mind as a mechanical system, then there are disturbing thoughts that can be said as disturbing forces. Then there are some restoring forces which kind of calms our mind. Then there are inertia forces which are only because of how our habits are formed. And then there is something called damping forces. Again, it's a part of the mind which do all those things. and that makes our mind stable, unstable, or periodic, so or chaotic. So it can be anything. Okay, so we can look like that. And obviously our mind is a non-linear thing, it's all interconnected everywhere. So what are the elementary parts? So elementary parts are, there is some means of storing potential energy. In this linear sense, we call this as linear spring. Then we have means of storing the kinetic energy. This is generally the mass, so Km, and last means by which energy is lost. And that can be given as C. Now coming to the solving of this equation of motion. Solving of this equation of motion should be after the forces. So let's say we have forces and mechanical system is defined. We have the equation of motion. Then what about the responses? So responses are generally called as vibrations, how the system is vibrating. So it can be in linear sense, it can be if there is no damping, it will go infinitely. So but in real world sense, it can be free or forced. Okay, free is what we learn in vibration courses, underdamped. Critically damped. And overdamped. And forced. We have all different dynamics all together. So we have damped, undamped. This will be, if it is free as well as damped, then these conditions will arrive. Next, if it is deterministic, like we can determine the solution, so we have some expression by which we know the solution, or it can be random. Sometimes the situation is so complex that we don't know where the noise is coming from, so that is where it's called, we classify in term of probabilities, and then we try to find the random signal response. Also the classification can be made as useful vibration. Or non-useful vibration. So obviously we have to increase useful vibration and decrease non-useful vibration, such as friction and bearing. An example of useful vibration can be music or something called energy harvesters. Okay. Now we start with the how this whole structure is defined. Like before 1990s, this course was to have the knowledge of the one bigger course called analytical dynamics. So to learn this course, we first learn vibrations. How the vibration was set up, that we learn about single degree of freedom. Then we learn about multi degree of freedom. And then we learn about continuous system. But how this course structure now is because of advent of numerical methods. As well as low patience among the students, because actually what happens is that it takes 2 to 3 years to learn these structure courses, and then finally we are able to understand how the codes, FEM codes work, so hence denoting this low patience among the students. Now what happens that we start with continuous system itself, before going into continuous system we try to have an idea about discrete system. So this is about formulation. We first have idea about discrete system, how to formulate them, and then we provide the same theory for the continuous system. And once we have this continuous system, we try to understand how this continuous system and single degree of freedom or 2 degree of freedom system behave solution wise. And then from this thing we can have an insight of the continuous system itself. So this is how this new world whole structure is. Hence you have seen that we have learned about, so this course is all about here, but if you will take how to find the solution of this, those equation of motion, which many of the equation of motion were non-linear, then it has a different subject altogether. So to sum up everything, we have first of all abstraction, then finding equation of motion, then we have how to solve this equation of motion, and finally how to interpret the solution, which is directly connected to the abstraction. So it's a closed loop thing. So this is how all the problems are solved. Now we will start with abstraction questions. So we have a hypothetical scenario here. Let's say the city of Gotham is in peril as a dangerous mechanical shark terrorizes its waters, sinking boats and endangering lives. Batman is here to determine to stop this threat and protect the people of Gotham. So this is a real shark. And this is kind of abstraction of it. As he began his investigation, he discovered the shark had been treated by one of his old foes, Joker. The Joker has always been known for his twisted sense of humor and love of chaos, but this latest scheme was on another level. He has created a sophisticated mechanical shark to wreak havoc on the city and its inhabitants. Now he knew he had to act fast, so he suited up and headed to the docks. He climbed aboard a high-tech submarine and that he has designed specifically for underwater missions and set off to pursuit of the shark. Now here what we'll do, we will try to see how the shark was built up. So as he closed in on the shark, Batman could see that it was an impressive piece of machinery. It was covered in razor sharp teeth and its metallic fin sliced through the water with ease. So how the shark is swimming. So Batman knew that he had to be careful as the shark was armed with powerful weapons and could pose a serious threat to his submarine. Now this piece of machinery was based on biomimicry of the shark along with the additional guns and torpedoes. So now how the fish swim, we'll look at that. So fish swim with rhythmic side to side S shape movement using their fins and body to push against the incompressible water. Now the paired pectoral fins, which is here, the red thing, are located on the each side and are homologous to the four limbs of the tetrapod. Tetrapod means having four limbs. Now the paired pelvic fin, the pelvic is this blue fin, are typically located behind this pectoral fin. And they are homologous to the hind limb of the tetrapod. Homologous meaning having the same function of. So as we use our hind limb, so it is homologous to that. So this red one are the hands and the blue one is kind of its leg. Dorsal fin are located on the back and it serves as to protect fish against rolling and assist them in sudden turns and stop. So it is used for locomotion, this dorsal fin. So we have two dorsal fin, one at anterior, which is in the median of this shark body, streamlined body. Another is posterior dorsal fin, which is a little bit back and it is also in the median of the shark streamlined body. Now caudal fins are tail fins used for propulsion. Caudal fins are going up and down and it gives the propulsion needed. So despite the danger, Batman was underrated and he used his submarine advanced technologies to outmaneuver the shark and disable his weapon systems. Now our task is to develop an abstraction model that can study the lateral stability in side-to-side movement. So this is how this locomotion of shark looks like. So you can see it's a S curve and it is changing its shape. Let me give you the impression of what it is. It is changing its shape like this. This can have many solutions, so we have to do the abstraction. The abstraction have the following steps. First is we have to be knowing the purpose of the abstraction. Then we have to look at the stages of the motion. Next, we have to look at the elements of abstraction. Which can be anything, but for discrete system it is mass, stiffness, and damping. We won't do damping as of today. And for continuous system, we have beam, which is the most popular one. Then we have torsional shaft, and also we have axial rod, or we can have one more strings, or we can have a combination of them. Okay, so this stiffness can be also torsional stiffness. As well as torsional damping, so it can be either of them or combination of them. And the last thing is inference. So in this locomotion of fish problem, the purpose is clearly defined as we have to study the lateral stability. So this is our purpose. Now let's see stages of the motion. So stages of the motion is so let's define an S curve. So this is how fish is moving in water. It is creating a vortex like this, which is giving it forward velocity. So let's say any fish is going in this direction, as it is going there. So it kind of changes shape. This to something like this. And this vortices will change. So this is the lateral stability we are talking about. So what are the things which are given? First of all, we have to realize that this median is in, it can be an idealized beam. Because that will take care of the transverse motion. Okay. Next is pectoral fin. Then dorsal fin. Followed by, so there are two dorsal fin, one is anterior, another is posterior. Then we have pelvic fin. Finally, the caudal fin. If we look at the locations, we can locate each and everything with the with respect to the median. The pectoral fin is at some distance from the median. Dorsal is exactly on the median. Pelvic is also like pectoral fin, it is from the offset from the median. And caudal is also along the median. So one simple abstraction using the continuous system. Now this abstraction can have many solution. What we are doing first is using the continuous system. So if we are using continuous system, let's have this structure. So this is just like a beam. Median is idealized. Now this can be put as the pectoral fin. It is also idealized as being similar color. Then there is pelvic fin. It is also idealized as beam. What about the remaining part? Remaining part are the dorsal fin, caudal fin. So dorsal fin, let us see where is it. It is between the pectoral fin and pelvic fin, where they are attached. So we can denote that as this. This can be our anterior dorsal fin. It is idealized as point mass. Similarly, the location of posterior dorsal fin is between pelvic and caudal fin, so somewhere here. And finally, there will be at the end, there will be caudal fin . So this can be one abstraction. Another abstraction using only discrete . Now instead of fin, we can provide . Now instead of this, we can provide something like this. So these can be our masses. can your point masses. Which is connected via spring. So here median instead of Adelaide as a beam is now Adelaide as discrete masses connected via springs. Similar approach can be used for very large now anterior dorsal fin will remain as point mass, and for the pelvic fin again we can use posterior fin will regain its point mass status, and caudal fin also will remain as point mass status. So, or it, we can have a combination of discrete element and continuous system. So, there could be lots of different abstraction regarding this. So let's see if how the problem is solved. Then with the shark now vulnerable, he prepared to board it and disable the control system from within. The fight was intense, but Batman was able to overpower the shark's robotic system and shut it down. The city of Gotham breathed a collective sigh of relief as the dangerous mechanical shark was defeated. As Batman returned to the docks, he reflected on the lessons he has learned from his experience. And we can move on to the second problem. Now, instead of shark, now we have cheetah. So, Gotham has the peril once again. As the new and dangerous threat has emerged, the villainous Two-Face has created a massive mechanical cheetah, which was named as Mecha Cheetah, to wreak havoc on the city and its citizens. Batman was determined to stop this threat and save Gotham. Batman quickly got to work studying the Mecha Cheetah and looking for its weakness. He discovered that the cheetah was powered by the highly advanced energy source, and that if he could find a way to disable that power source, he could stop the Mecha Cheetah. But getting close enough to the Mecha Cheetah to disable its power source would be no easy task. The cheetah was fast and agile, and it was armed with a variety of dangerous weapons. Batman knew that he would have to be careful, as one wrong move could mean the end of his mission. To determine to save this city, he abstracted the whole cheetah, that we are doing it now. So this is the cheetah, and as you can see, it is the fastest animal on the land. So how to abstract it, like what is special in that cheetah? So actually the special part is its backbone, which kind of flex and extend. So it kind of stores energy and then releases it. So in that way, it's that release of energy is a sudden burst. And if we abstract the backbone as a beam, so we can have the flexion as the extension, just as the fish. Or we can abstract using torsion spring, because it will get compressed and then come back to shape. Or we can use simple springs such as this. This mechanism can also be put. So Batman realized that the backbone is the major thing in cheetah. So Two-Face was furious as his plan was failed, and he vowed to get his revenge on Batman. Okay, so let me just define the question. So this is question number one. Which is abstraction question. This is question number two. Again, is the abstraction question. Moving on to question number four. Sorry, three. It is also an abstraction question. So now this Batman is in Batcave working on a new project. He is developing a special forging hammer that would allow him to forge a new or improved weapon to help him in his battle against the villain of Gotham. As he worked, he noticed that there is a problem with the hammer. It is too stiff, and it was able to transfer enough energy to the metal that was trying to forge, and this meant that he wasn't able to forge the weapon that he needed to protect. Determined to find the solution, Batman began to study the mechanics of the forging hammer. He quickly discovered that stiffness of the hammer was the root problem, and that he needed to find a way to make the system more flexible. So theoretically, Batman realizes that he could create a bilinear stiffness system. What does this bilinear stiffness mean? Is, let's say, this forging hammer, it consists of a frame, a falling weight known as tup, or in this case hammer, an anvil, and a foundation block. So this anvil is a massive steel block on which material is forged into the desired shape by the repeated blows of the hammer. The anvil is usually mounted on this elastic pad to reduce the transmission of this vibration to the foundation block, okay, this frame. And the anvil and the foundation block are quite stiff compared to the elastic pad and the soil. Now, first of all, we have to represent the system as 2 degree of freedom model by considering the weight of the frame plus anvil and the foundation block separately. And we can assume that a pad is composed of the linear elastic material. So it's a linear system. We can abstract in such a way. Secondly, the second question is, now suppose that the elastic pad is composed of a bilinear material that has force displacement curve as shown in the figure. We have to modify the abstraction in part A to reflect this change. So figure B is that force displacement curve, like as the displacement occurs at a certain delta naught, the stiffness changes of the system. We have to first abstract part A. Let's go for part A. So as the anvil and the foundational block are quite stiff, as compared to the elastic pad, as well as soil, we can have this is that hammer. It is falling down, and this hammer is having this weight M0. Now it is falling, on this M1, which is frame, as well as anvil. It is connected to a damper. Stiffness and this we can term as M2. This is foundation block. Elastic pad, similarly we will have soil stiffness. So this is a part. For part B, we have to devise a bilinear stiffness which is somewhat like this. So so this is having the bilinear stiffness, but what makes the difference between parallel stiffness is that the second stiffness will act at the at some distance. So this is delta naught and this is having the stiffness k1 and this is having stiffness k2 minus k1. So when this engage, the equivalent stiffness is k2. What we will do, we will have the same figure. Instead of this elastic pad, we will give this where this distance is delta naught and the stiffness are k2 minus k1 and this is k1. So for some part this k1 will be there, and as it crosses the delta naught, the equivalent stiffness will be k1 plus k2 minus k1. K1 k1 cancels and everything is now k2. So let's take a 5-minute break. And then we will also see one more
part we can do abstraction question in the later classes. Now we will move on to the today's topic, constraints. So 5 minute break. Okay, let's continue. So let's talk about constraints. So in mechanics, we have two type of constraints. One is called holonomic, and other is, as the name suggests, non-holonomic. So any constraint can have two ways of writing. One way is called Pfaffen form and another way is algebraic form. So if Pfaffen form can be converted into algebraic form, then that is called as holonomic constraint. And if Pfaffen form cannot be converted as algebraic form, then it is called non-holonomic. And it is also defined by conditions called as condition for exactness of differential form. So if it follow that condition, then it's called a holonomic constraint. Otherwise, it's called non-holonomic constraint. So let's see what this Pfaffen form is all about. So if we have constraint on velocities, then it's called as, then it can be written as this, a differential form. And we can write this as a Pfaffen form as, removing the time derivative and putting them into right-hand side, and then again, so this time derivative, this dot terms, taking into that side and then putting into left-hand side, which will lead us into Pfaffen form, which is as this condition. So necessary condition for general form of holonomic is if this Pfaffen form can be converted into this algebraic form. For that, it is must that these conditions are satisfied, which is called as conditions for exactness of a differential form. If this doesn't satisfy, then this Pfaffen form cannot be converted into algebraic form. Okay, so let us put constraint into some sci-fi setting. So we have a movie called Tron, where it is all about constraint, because vehicles and everything is in form of a matrix and everything is there is constrained in that form. So let's say we have a bike, a Tron bike, and these are the coordinates. So x direction is where this vehicle is traversing, or the vehicle is moving. Y is where it will take turns, and Z is the vertical upward. So our first constraint is Z is equal to 0,
meaning that the vehicle cannot lift off from the surface of this matrix. Another is, the second constraint is the distance between these points x1, x2. So let's have these points defined. This is point number 1, and this is z1, this is x1, this is y1. Similarly, this is z2, this is x2, this is y2, this is point number 2. So distance between point 1 and point 2 is constant throughout. This is also second constraint. So this will be given in a relation where we know that z1 and z2 are not changing. So there will be relation between x2 minus x1 whole square plus y2 minus y1 whole square is constant at some L, so equal to L square. The third condition is where this vehicle cannot move in y direction. Hence, vg means of this vehicle, the velocity of this vehicle in x direction dot n direction, n is the normal, which at this moment is the y direction, which is coming out of the screen or going inside the screen. So if we denote that in term of I and j cap, we get vg is equal to x1 dot plus x2 dot divided by 2, I plus y1 dot plus y2 dot divided by 2j, and in term of cos theta and sin theta, we can write n as l cos theta I cap plus minus l sin theta j cap, where cos theta is equal to x2 minus x1 by l, sin theta is equal to y2 minus y1 by l, and if we simplify it, we get this relationship x1 dot plus x2 into y2 minus y1 and y1 dot plus y2 into x2 minus x1 equal to 0. So this is the combination of velocity as well as displacement. And if we have to check this condition, del of A J I by del of Q K equal to del of A J K by del of Q I. As well as del of A J I by del of T is equal to del of A J T by del of Q I. So if we have to see if that constraint is holonomic or non-holonomic, then we get third constraint is given as z is equal to 0, means dz is equal to 0. So this is a Prokofiev form. Also, z1, z2, x1, x2, y1, y2 are the degree of freedom or generalized coordinate where this z is equal to 0 means z1 is equal to 0 as well as z2 is equal to 0. This gives us the perfect form as dz1 is equal to 0 and dz2 is equal to 0. So if we define the j denoting the 1 and 2, 1 as this equation 1 and j equal to 2 is equation number 2. So this is denoting equations j1i is for equation 1, j2i is for equation 2, and I stands for generalized coordinate. So our 1a11 will become as 0, a12 will become as 0. Let's say this is 1, this is 2 3 4 5 as well as 6. A13 again 0, A14 again 0, A15, now that is not 0, that is 1, A16 is again 0. Now similarly, if we talk about A21, A22, A23, A24, A25, A26. So only A26 will be 1 and else others will be 0, because there is a presence of only Z2 and there is no T in the picture. So A1T is equal to 0 as well as A2T is also 0. Now upon using the condition, you can see it satisfies that, because only way it will be non-zero is when A16 by del z1 5 equal to since everything is constant, so and if we differentiate respect to any coordinate we will get 0. So all these relationship will be 0 equal to 0. So this is satisfied, hence it's the holonomic constraint. But if we talk about the second constraint, we can write in the Pufferfin form x2 minus x1 whole square plus y2 minus y1 whole square plus, let's say, z2 minus z1 whole square is equal to l square. So in the Pufferfin form, is x2 minus x1 dx2 minus dx1 So this will be the case, this is equal to 0, and if we convert them into the Pufferfin form, so this will become as x1 minus x2 dx1 plus x2 minus x1 dx2 plus y1 minus y2 dy1 plus y2 minus y1 dy2 plus z1 minus z2 dz1 plus z2 minus z1 dz2 is equal to 0. So here we have only one equation, these will become this will be come out to be x1 minus x2 x2 minus x1 y1 minus y2 y2 minus y1 z1 minus z2 z2 minus z1, this is equal to 0. But there is no content of time in this constraint. So now if we check this condition, we can see if they still satisfy. If we put I as 1 to 6, so this is also a holonomic constraint. And if we look at the third constraint, where the dot terms were there,
if we write this in a Perfection form, the condition will become as such. So now if we satisfy, so here A1 will only be there, A11 will come as. So let us denote in term of Q1 and Q2. So A11 becomes Q5 minus Q2, A12 becomes Q1 minus Q4, A13 becomes 0, A14 becomes Q5 minus Q2, A15 is Q1 minus Q4. A16 equal to 0, and similarly T1 is also 0. Now if you look at the condition of the exactness, so it is not satisfying. A non-holonomic constraint. And this is Batman violating this constraint. So the vehicle is moving in this direction as denoted in that direction. Now rolling a penny is also a form of non-holonomic constraint. So the expression is something like this: x at the point T dot minus r cos phi theta dot is equal to 0, and y at point P minus r to sine phi into theta dot is equal to 0. So this we will also cover in gyroscope, these different angle of precision and this pen. So from the next class, we will look at different how to tackle the holonomic constraint mostly. And if the differential form of the non-holonomic constraint is given, then finding out the solution of finding out the equation of motion using Euler language equations with the help of language multiplier. So this we will start from the next class. We first start with the abstraction question and then we will move to Hamilton law of waiting action, and then we will look at the language equation of motion, Euler language equation of motion. Okay, so this completes our practice session 9. So this ends our today's class. Thank you for being till then. I will stop recording now.